in a culture that is comment-driven rather than conversation-driven, what if we actually modeled having a conversation, different backgrounds, different perspectives around faith, life, and culture, and find this common place? Hey, what's up? I'm Torrin Wells, and this is Faith, Life, and Culture. These conversations revolve around this album, Citizen of Heaven. As we started writing some of these songs, I started thinking, maybe these songs are just one layer to a deeper conversation. So when I had the thought of putting together a faith, life, and culture conversation, I thought, let me put together a dream list of people.
Well, I'm Tim Tebow, and when Torrin called and asked me if I could be part of this, I said yes, because I think it's important when we actually do come together and have a relationship, because the church isn't a building we go to, it's a people that we do life with. And also, I love what Torrin does. I love what he stands for. I love his heart. To be able to support him means a lot to me.
I think people see Tim in this golden boy light, but he has been through some serious setbacks in his life. He just keeps getting back up to just keep coming at life.
My name is Rich Wilkerson Jr., and I pastor a church called VU Church in Miami, Florida. I think that we live in a world right now that everyone wants to be black and white. I think he has a really, really unique way of bringing both the sacred and the secular together. I found a whole lot of inspiration in it.
I wanted to have someone who has with integrity carried their faith into pop culture. He's great friends with Justin Bieber and Kim and Kanye. Rich is one of the leading voices in celebrity culture today.
My name is Tori Kelly. I'm a singer-songwriter, musician.
One of the most brilliant singers that I think I've ever heard. She's held on to who she is in the midst of an industry that wants to tell you who you need to be.
My faith has always been something super important to me. So when I heard, you know, there's going to be a bunch of people sort of in all different walks of life, all different sorts of platforms, it just kind of excited me.
Travis Green brings energy and life into every room he walks into.
I love people who are the same off stage as they are on stage. And he's one of those people. He's a friend of everyone.
He has planted a church and yet tours and makes music. He's such a creative.
Hey, I'm Annie F. Downs, and I am here today because Torrin is just so good at making art that changes me. This feels like a real honor to be here.
A communicator, author, she has a podcast, being a real thought leader, how we wrestle through some of the tough questions of our faith.
When Torrin called me, I thought, man, they're asking me to speak into this?
Social Club Misfits, Marty and Fern.
Anything for friends, anything for our family, Torrin to be family.
Fern was released from prison. Marty was released from religion.
To sit down with these other people of same faith and same beliefs, but we see things through different lenses. How could I pass on it?
It's either this or playing video games at my house.
John Crist has made his platform poking fun at some of Christian culture. Comedians are very deep people who are using humor to process things that they're wrestling with.
All of us are coming from different perspectives, authors and athletes and comedians and pastors and musicians. Even within our faith, there's so many different nuances of opinions and thoughts. I feel like for all of us to come together, we can all benefit from each other.
I just wanted to say thank you guys for being here. It's really, I didn't even know to dream this. There have been a lot of things in my life that I've experienced that I thought, how did this happen? And I think I'll look back on this moment as one of those. Thank you guys for lending your influence, your platforms, your thoughts, your faith into this and who you are. You bring so much to it. But I would love to put together a dream list of people who I feel like would lend unique perspectives and really add some heart and soul to the conversations.
And they weren't available, so you got us. All right? Is that a dream list?
Second tier?
They were super busy.
Yeah. No, we got you. Exactly.
It's John's job to tell the first joke, okay?
Sorry,
you can't
sorry,
do that.
Sorry.
You beat him to it.
Yeah.
Tag, you're in.
It's all yours.
I'm just happy to have so much talent here. And Rich. It's just nice.
Oh, there it is. There it is.
We're all here. You know what I'm saying? It feels good.
I love it.
True. Touche.
So just like everyone has a different gift, a different emphasis, a different platform. And, you know, songwriters, authors, athletes, comedian, pastors, hip-hop artists. I think it's amazing when you take what we do, whether it's a sketch or a lyric, and then you go three layers deeper. Like, where did that come from? Even though we like to think our stuff is deep and thought-provoking, really I think it's a few questions deep that we really get to the good stuff. So I hope to dig into some of that today, but I just wanted to say thank you from the bottom of my heart. I really appreciate it. Rich, you wanna
Let's pray
for us?
Lord, we just thank you for this opportunity that we have today. And Lord, we just thank you for the people that you brought together in this room, that we believe, Lord, that it was you who's orchestrating all of that. So we just want to make sure that right now, Lord, we prepare our hearts, that we're available, that we're sensitive, Lord, that wherever the conversation leads us, God, that people would feel vulnerable, transparent, feel comfortable, that this is a safe place amongst friends, and that we can have a fun time and a great conversation.
The point of this conversation today was not to bring a bunch of people together to tell the world all the answers. The point of the conversation was to let the world know we have questions too. And we have to figure out how to navigate through life's tough questions together. Thank you guys for being a part of this conversation around faith, life, and culture. You know, this has been a journey for me. I've been writing an album called Citizen of Heaven.
Let's go.
And super excited about the music. The cool thing about my creative process, and it may be like this for many of you, writing books, writing sketches, writing sermons, where the thoughts begin very personally. Perhaps it's something that God is dealing with you on, that you're walking through, or that you're seeing in someone's life. But you know, ultimately, it's going to be consumed both at a personal level and a communal level. You know that you're going to be speaking to a large group of people. So I want to know, as we dig into some of this, how have your personal experiences shaped your faith? And how do you carry your faith into your real life and into the real world? And I want to jump in to this first song.
Let's go.
It is the title track of the album. It's called Citizen of Heaven.
Let's go.
Space bar.
Getting caught up in the here and now has a tendency to wear me down. Am I really free if I'm thinking about only temporary things? The world screaming so loud when I'm locked in the middle of my doubt. When I'm lost in the rhythm of the crowd, I hear heaven calling me. Don't wanna be another victim, falling prey to the system, when you've called me into the kingdom.
Heaven, my eternity forever is yours.
then fire. Yeah, right.
Yeah, fire.
With a Pharrell drum.
Yeah, that's
crazy.
Oh,
when I wrote that song.
He got right to it.
When I got that voice memo from Travis, I was like,
that was this.
You know, we live in a culture that is comment-driven rather than conversation-driven. Mm-hmm. And for some reason, like, we have all bought into this idea that we're going to change the world in the comment section on Facebook.
Wow.
And I really think that it's settings like this where change really happens, where you have real conversations around ideas. And this idea to me, it's such a big idea, being a citizen of heaven. But I think really it's an idea around identity. Mm-hmm. And I know that every one of us at some point, you've had to figure out who you are and what it means to be a child of God. Mm-hmm. How does this message resonate with you of being a citizen of heaven? Open-ended question. Who's gonna be the bold first person?
He's like, so Rich, what do you think about that? Right, right.
I think what's like really cool about it is I think sometimes like there's like these words like in church that we hear if you grew up in church. I grew up in church, but like sometimes like something like citizen of heaven would sound like something that like Christians would say, like, what does that actually mean?
Yeah.
But there's a whole lot of like deep theological like context that you have to understand, which is the fact of the matter is that like the gospel is not this whole behavior message. The gospel is this whole transformation from the inside out, which is what you're talking about, identity. Mm-hmm. And I like the fact that you're able to put lyric and sound behind this phrase. That's an old, it's an old phrase, citizen of heaven.
Yeah.
But with the sound of it, it creates a new wave. And I think it's a conversation starter because this is what it's about. I mean, this is like, I love what you're talking about, like conversations where change happens. And when you're talking about like identity, I'm still learning my identity. I'm still becoming.
Yes.
I'm not there yet. You know what I mean?
Right.
I still have insecurities and things, but my faith in Jesus is the thing that changes everything. And so songs like this to me are great conversation starters because you can start, what does that even mean to be a citizen of heaven?
Yeah.
Well, it's like, yo, Jesus didn't come to make bad people good. He came to make dead people alive.
Yeah.
He came to resurrect something inside of all of us and that we are now co-heirs and we're part of something far greater. Right. This life has got troubles and I'm still going to deal with some insecurities. I'm still going to deal with problems and suffering, but I'm promised an eternity because I'm a citizen of something else. And so I think in the culture we live in, this is something that has to be talked about more and more. And I feel like the identity piece is vital. That's what the gospel's about.
Yeah.
I think that's really good, Rich. I think first thing for me is that it's encouraging. Yeah. And you know, you mentioned in there about the voices because there are so many chances in life to listen to voices. Mm-hmm. But I also believe we have a choice to listen to certain voices. That's and right. What voices we let in and what voices that we try to block. And this is so encouraging because you're painting a picture of this is not your home. This is not it, not yet.
Right.
But one day we are citizens of heaven. When you know Jesus, you're a citizen of heaven. He adopted you into the family of God. You went from darkness to light. Your eternity is sealed. And we get to hold on to that. And now you get to encourage people by saying, hey, listen, it might not be the way you want it right now. But this isn't your home. You're a citizen of heaven where you're going one day. And I think for believers that are wrestling with that or that are maybe even being kind of shaken with that, it's such an encouraging message to them to say, hey, just hang on.
Yeah.
Just keep fighting. Keep hanging on because this isn't your home. You're going home one day, and that's going to be great.
It's easy for Tim to say. He's never been criticized before.
That's hilarious.
And I think it's powerful coming from him.
Yeah,
to say
right,
that.
Right. Miles Monroe once said, he was a phenomenal preacher. He once said, I'd rather be called a citizen than a Christian. Mm. And his Inspire. Whole idea was that salvation, this whole thing, the gospel, is not about getting, not as much about getting us to heaven as it is about getting heaven here. Mm. If heaven was the goal, then as soon as you said yes to Christ, you'd die.
Yeah. And I think when you look at the word citizen and you're going, okay, what does it mean to be a citizen of somewhere? It's not just what you get as a citizen. It's what you give back if you're a citizen.
Great.
Good. It's your loyalty
Good.
To the place
Good.
You're a citizen of, too. And so it just feels like it could start this really long conversation about, like, am I given what I'm supposed to give if I'm a citizen of heaven?
Well, I mean, what does that look like in everyday life? Like, what does that look like for you? What are you contributing? Obviously, we know you're writing books, you have your podcast, but in a real tangible way for people, how do we walk as citizens in the world here and now?
I think that the first thing that hit me kind of hard is When you understand that you're a citizen, you have to understand why you're a citizen.
Good. Mm-hmm.
And that's what just hit me after what you said, Travis, was that Jesus came on a rescue mission so that we could be made whole with his dad. Mm-hmm. So that whether it is eternal life in heaven, whether it's having a relationship with Jesus here on this earth, but that we're made right with the Father, and so that we have a perfect relationship where that there's not that block of sin between us and him. We're made right. And so when we understand that we're a citizen, we understand why we're a citizen. And why we're a citizen is because we were loved enough by the Father for him to break the perfect relationship with his Son, for him to come down this earth, go on a rescue mission, be persecuted, be crucified, shame, and have his dad turn his back on his own Son for us. And then we get to accept that and be made right with God the Father. And that's how we become part of the, we become a citizen of heaven, yeah, is through that act. I mean, we're citizen heaven. Yeah. It's just the drastic difference because of what Jesus did is everything.
Yes.
Yeah. It's all of it.
Yeah. Yeah.
Gospel
sure.
is a common thing of all of it.
I think without recognizing how important we are to God's mission, mm-hmm, it can make us as believers lazy. Because it's all the great by and by, when I get there.
Yeah.
And God is like, okay, that's great. Yeah, that's sealed. Yeah. But, you know, the Lord's Prayer, let your kingdom come, let your will be done on earth as it is in heaven. We're a citizen of that kingdom called to a colony in order to infiltrate it and make a change. And what your question is, on a practical level, I think it looks like Tori. I think it looks like Tim. I think it looks like getting outside of our safety net of church, at where we're just saying, hey, come here, come over here, and saying, you know what? I'm actually going to come to you.
Yeah.
I'm going to engage the culture, and I'm going to bring the kingdom. And my wife says it best, that the kingdom of God is not counterculture to the world.
Yeah.
It's the world is counterculture to the actual culture that matters.
Yeah. Right.
And so it's us going where they are. You know, embracing
our citizenship.
Yeah, embracing the Great Commission, not the Great Suggestion.
That's right.
And going and saying, yo, this is the way.
So I've heard you speak on this through Engage Culture Conference and the conversations that you have. You have broken down how we as believers operate within the culture. What do we do? How do we respond?
Yeah, well, culture is all around us. First of all, it's undeniable. It's the rhythm of a generation. And I think there's three responses you can have. You can complain about it, which the church has become very professional at.
Really good at that.
people. Yeah, you could conform to it and just say, well, this seems like the way, and live downstream instead of upstream. Or you can confront it. And confronting it is literally getting where they are. You know, practical for me, it's way easier. It would be easier and cheaper if I toured in churches. You know, any church, come on, you know, this is great. You know, and wouldn't have any overhead. But I'll be going somewhere where everyone's well.
Yeah.
And that's not what we're called to do. So instead, it looks, you know, we do our tours in bars and in clubs and in theaters, and we see, you know, thousands of salvations, you know, out here where the people are. I think from a practical tip, that's what it looks like. It looks like befriending people who don't look like you, who may not come to your church. I think one of the greatest compliments Jesus got is the accusation that he was a friend of sinners.
Yes.
How cool is that?
Yeah.
You know, this dude was, and had dinner with the IRS.
Book.
We run from the IRS.
Right.
He was like, yo, Zacchaeus, I'm coming to your house, actually. We're going to have dinner and hang out.
Right.
But he was about that life, and I think that's what it looks like.
Travis, I've known you like 7 minutes now. I really like you, dude.
I'm a little bit confused here because I thought we were critiquing the music. I was just, it goes citizen of heaven. I would just have gone heaven. I'm okay. I know you're like a music guy and I'm not, but that's it. Yeah.
I want to hear from you because your platform has been built on, in a way, critiquing Christian culture.
Sure, yeah.
Are there real areas that we just overlook and need to really think about?
I feel like it's hard here because everybody has this great spiritual Christian message, but what we're forgetting is that the track has to be a banger. No, really,
to
take the message, you'd be like, dude, I got this inspirational quote, but the song sucks.
Yeah.
It's not going anywhere.
Yeah.
So, like, everybody, whatever they produce here,
it's great.
Like,
Tim is like an awesome message, but also a very attractive, muscular man.
Yeah, that, right. So people want to listen.
No, I'm not. You're right. Like, you're really serious. Right. You do lots of things in your church. Like, let's say we'll have bagels, or we'll have some kind of to get worldly things to get people there. Mm-hmm. You went to a church very similar to mine that I would always go. There's music and there's hangouts, and whatever reason you came there, once the service starts, you have to confront the Holy Spirit. Mm-hmm. So if you came, I like this guy's music, mm-hmm. and it gets in, and then you sit with it, and it's like, oh. Yeah. So a lot of times I get, hey, help us promote this or help us do this. Like, we have an awesome message. And I go, yeah, but it's not good.
Right.
Yeah. Good. And so, like, we put money into production and cameras and light to make it good. And yes. But I don't think that's anti.
It's not anti the gospel.
It's not.
To be good. I love a couple of things about what you just said. I think the Bible is very clear. Whatever hand finds to do it with all your might, as unto the Lord. There's nothing the Bible says that you shouldn't be good or try to be the best at whatever you do.
Yeah.
But when you're doing all those things, you better try to be the best at what matters most, which is the Great Commission, is loving your family, is loving your neighbors, is loving the least, the last, and the lost. Yeah. And so, you know, it's just, we need to be good at these things, but we can't just be good at these things.
Right.
But we should be the best at what matters most. Good. But I 100% agree with you, though. People sometimes even ask me, is it okay that, you know, we're doing so good in business, or is it okay?
Well, that's a real question.
This is, you know, off business people sometimes ask me, you know, we're doing really well, but what should we do? Are you kidding me? Make as much as you can and give it away.
Absolutely. Yeah.
Make as much as you can, because you know what? If God's in control of your life and you have the money, then you can help the kids that need it most. Right?
I fully agree. I think the thing that John's saying, though, is really vital to the conversation, because ultimately, if the song wants to be a ministry tool or a conversation starter, it's got to be good. And we talk about this whole idea of reconciling, like, Christian culture, or, you know, being a citizen of another and dual citizenship. It's like the best thing in the world to study that we kind of all forget about is like the exile, like the actual literal exile. The Israelites are living, you know, like in Babylon. Yep. They're like under, we think America is bad culturally. Like, bro, they were like, you know, like, I don't need to give you the historical facts of Babylon, but none of our parties have touched their, you know, like the.
Sure. It was bad.
Yeah, the depravity was on another level if we're going to actually rate sin. Yet, the thing that made Daniel, I hate to be the pastor guy right now, stand out was a spirit of excellence. That's what he's talking about. It's like being being great at what you're doing. When you mix that then with a spirit for God, that's where the combustion happens. Yeah. And like they were asking me, like, why are you here with Torn today? I'm like, because I think what you bring to the table is that you've got this incredible gift mix, you've got this incredible talent and this skill that you've been sharpening. But then there's this spirit behind you, and I think that you are bringing a beautiful combustion right now, the secular and the sacred. And that's the stuff I get excited about the most. It's like, there's no telling where this is gonna go. Yeah.
Let me say this, because Tori's sitting here, and talk about making an impact in culture without this idea of being salt and light in culture. Salt and light are both silent. I think sometimes we think we're going to be defined by how loud we are as Christians. Jeez. But when I sat with Adam Blackstone, who is the man behind so many mainstream artist live shows, he said, a lot of times it's what I don't say. Mm. It's what I don't do. And you've put out so many different albums, but recently won a Grammy for this amazing gospel album. And somehow you have brought your faith in a palatable way into the culture. But I saw people like hashtagging your Instagram stuff with like Renaissance, because people,
Torin, that never happened.
I hashtagged.
No,
that.
I did. No,
was that you?
No, that was me.
No,
I'm in your comments every day. You don't ever respond, but
no, hashtag Renaissance.
It's when believers, the Renaissance happened when believers set the creative standard in the world.
Wow.
And so, and they weren't calling it Christian. Well, but people were calling it great.
What you were saying, John, was making me think of this book I've read called Christians in the Arts, by Steve Turner, I believe. And that book really opened my eyes, because it was exactly what you were saying. It was like, why is there this separation between, you know, Christians and like the church culture versus just like you know, the word secular even is just like secular art. Like, why is there a separation, like you were saying too, Rich, about just making great art? And he makes a really cool point in the book. He's like, if you're going to the doctor's office, you don't need to go to a Christian doctor. You're going to a doctor who might happen to be a Christian.
Yeah.
And that doctor who happens to be a Christian is going to still do his job really well and the way that he was taught to do it, but he's going to live his life in a way that's pleasing to God. It's just a part of him. His faith is a part of him. So that analogy really hit me because it's like, okay, I'm a musician and I make art. I want it to be good art. And, you know, I'm also a Christian. So how do those things... you know, those things should just be one.
Yeah,
and so even if you're not on a stage or whatever, I think it's in everything that we do, like whatever your job is, whatever your platform is. You actually said something cool at your show. Every one of us has some sort of platform, especially with like social media now. Yeah, it's like we literally all have a stage in some capacity.
Yeah.
And I really liked that you said that because I just think it's true. So.
Yeah. And how we use it and steward it, we can easily use it to just make ourselves look awesome.
Yeah.
Or we can make things that show God's glory. When God wanted to display his glory, what did he do? Created.
Yeah. Yeah.
So many times the church cannibalizes creativity. We take the people that are the most creative and then we just consume them in negativity because we just don't get it.
Yeah.
And almost as if creativity is a distraction from God's glory when it's actually an expression of it.
Mm.
And so around the circle,
it's really good.
It's just creative people creating things that aren't like the things that you're posting on social media to me are not a distraction. Like one of my favorite things, which I'm a little bitter that I didn't make it in the worship leader.
Oh, my bad, dude, my bad. Yeah.
You had Israel up there? Yeah, like if you needed a biracial play, that's obviously me. So it's like.
How many people hit you up like mad that you didn't make fun of them? Yeah, make fun of me, man.
Yeah.
After this, he's gonna destroy you, bro.
Yeah.
So get ready, you know, he's got some
stuff. It's like, no. Crushed. He likes me now. That's why he's making fun of me.
Well, I would say that every person in here that's creating something, maybe for a Christian culture or against it, we all are been outspoken or identified as believers.
Right.
And we've all created a piece of something that the culture has told us was too far. Mm-hmm. Everybody in here, mm-hmm. we're like, that was, right? I didn't believe you're too, or my, hey, John, we love you, we're cool with you, but...
Yep. Yeah. For sure.
That wasn't it. Sure. And I see sometimes artists kind of be like, I'm going to use this like Christian platform until I'm big enough and then I can, and kind of leave them.
Yeah.
And I love them. I love them dearly. And it's not necessarily that I'm going to be like, I'm out. It's like, I'm going to try to go one or two steps and see if y'all can come. You know what I'm saying? Because I'm not interested in leaving this community. My heart breaks when we, like you said, somebody has a misstep and we just, man, this was our shot to like prove that we're like loving and compassionate.
Everyone has a misstep.
Yeah.
The question is, are other people going to see it or not?
That's exactly right.
Yeah. But I would want to encourage you that I think what you do is good for people. I think your ability to bring joy and light and happiness and probably you don't get as much encouragement as a lot of people here for, you're doing the ministry, right?
Right. Yeah.
But being able to bring that in a funny way where, you know what, Christians can't make fun of each other. We can't have fun and we can't be vulnerable and all these things. I think it's a good thing. And I think you probably got a lot of flack early because it wasn't acceptable, you know?
Some
of the churches that I grew up in. You can't do that, you know?
Yeah.
And they also said I couldn't play, you know, sports on Sunday afternoon after church, you know?
Yeah. Right.
So
that's true. Somebody told me that it was like my voice, and a lot of people I think are similar in here that like, I see some people critical of all you guys publicly. I'm like, everyone has asked me about people like you, hey, what's Annie like? What's Rich like? What? Like, I bet the person you hate the most on the internet, I bet if you talk to them, you'll be like, oh, I get it.
Yeah.
Right?
Yeah.
That's everything right there. Bro.
Yeah.
Carl Lentz said, distance creates distortion.
Mm. Whoa. Yeah.
It is really hard to hate people up close.
Yes.
Wow.
And that is the problem with the social media culture is we feel close.
Yeah.
But like you guys actually talked about this in your podcast, Annie, That's So Fun podcast, which I'm a fan of and I've been on.
Yeah.
Holla at your boy.
Y'all are all welcome.
But you guys talked about this, since we are talking about identity, people feeling like they know you.
Yeah.
But
we talk about it a lot.
They don't
in real
have
life.
A clue.
Yeah. Yeah. I mean, but do they have a clue? I mean, the truth is, what they do know of us is true.
Yeah.
Right? Like, what they see, we aren't someone else in posted my Insta stories.
That's right. Oh, that's right.
Right? Right? They actually do know us.
Yes.
Right? But it's like what they do with what they know, the part they fill in the blank after. Mm-hmm. We give them 80% of our, we give them 3 minutes of our day.
Right.
And they fill in the other 23 hours.
Yes.
Right? And so that's where you have to have your real people. Mm. It's why you have to have people that are off the internet that can text you and go like, hey, I don't care what I saw up there today, but I saw this thing in your eye that tells me you're not all right.
Yeah.
Right? And you just got to have those people, because that goes back to that identity thing like Rich and Tim were saying of, if we actually believe that we are who God says we are, then you've got to have people that can look you in the face and say, yeah, that actually is who you are.
Yeah,
and if someone turned the lights off at Instagram or on any of our work, who is still going to know you?
That's great. Yeah. That's good.
And that matters massively to me.
And be able to call you out, too.
Right.
Like, not just the reminding you of your identity, but also be able to say, hey, I don't, you know.
That's not
and
who
that's
you
what
are.
We believe.
Is that
that's
who
not
you
who
want to be?
Yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah,
exactly.
Because, like, you know, people on the internet telling us great things about us, you're like, yeah, but you don't know about yesterday.
Right.
And you don't know. But then my real-life friends go, like, hey, Annie, that
don't
thing
point
you...
at me.
Yeah, sorry.
I'm not her friend.
That's it. Your real-life friends can say, I'm proud of you for what you did. And you go, like, you actually know me.
Yeah.
And you actually know
something.
What I had to walk through to get here. Yeah. Yeah. And so that says more to me than anything.
Yes.
Yeah.
That actually...
That's really good.
Yes. There's a song called Trenches. And I'm just going to play a little bit of it because I don't want to... crazy, but waste time listening to the music.
Stop
I want to talk
it.
About
Stop it.
It.
We got
to
hear some of this, man.
In addition to being good, and it's so small what I'm about to say, but I think it's important. I think we got to be like nice too.
Yes.
Like just likable. You know, when you see Rich, you know, he hangs with like the coolest people on the planet, but he's likable though. You know what I'm saying? Like the people who hated Jesus weren't sinners. They were religious people. Like those are people who killed him.
Right.
He, you know, the prostitute, they ain't have no problem. You know, the tax collector, they have no problem.
Right.
Like, he kicked it with them because he was likable. There was something about him, apart from preaching, apart from churching, there was just something about him that was like, oh, this is a cool guy. Like, I just like being around him.
Yeah.
And I think that...
I think when important. I stepped out and, like, started creating or started building, started leading, like, I always expected, like, criticism, like, you know, any kind of basic leadership 101, like, get ready, there's going to be resistance. I think I've just been shocked to see how much friendly fire I got. Like, that's what I wasn't counting
from
on.
From inside, right.
I'm ready to take some bullets. I just didn't know it was going to be like,
I didn't know it was going to be for my team.
Right, exactly.
For my team.
Yo, I don't know what I'm doing,
friendly
man.
Fire,
like, but
dude.
We cool, I thought. I'm here in my space, like, trying to live and lead and trying to make a difference, and you're over there, and like, wow. And
call
I think the
me.
Internet's, call me, man. Pick up the, like, I would love to have a conversation, and I don't have all this figured out, you know? And so it is a weird, funny world that we're living in, but I, once again, like the whole identity thing, I find just so much comfort in Jesus.
Yeah.
It's not just preaching. It's like, this is the thing that keeps me going.
Yeah.
Man wasn't afraid to be guilty by association.
Exactly.
Man wasn't afraid to be completely misrepresented.
Exactly.
And I think we grow stronger, we grow bigger. And I think that the criticism, if you respond the right way, it can, instead of define you, it can refine.
Climbing
Jesus' prayer request was that they would be one as we are one. If Jesus is praying the prayer for unity, how important is it to the heart of God?
Wow.
You know, so I think, how does the gospel create unity? When you're talking about being a citizen, and how does this idea of a man, God, dying on the cross bring people together?
You know, it's just been something I've been so passionate about, is trying to get different denominations to work together. The greatest time in my life was when Billy Graham came to Florida, and then all of the churches rallied, and over 100 of them worked together to support and bring people when Billy Graham came. Besides that, when do you ever see that? You really don't. And I just think hopefully they take a lesson from this. And it's one thing our Night to Shine tries to do is, we're so grateful. We got 35 denominations that are part of it. And I was like, there's 35 denominations?
The thing is, you aren't asking them to come around being unified. You're asking them to come around something that matters more.
Yes.
And so that's why they're all coming. They're not coming because you said, I want all these churches to be together. They're coming because you said, the least of these, the people that we don't see that really deserve to be seen, come and look at them. And everybody went, well, I know is that's true. So we're coming.
And I think the other thing is we have to agree to disagree on certain things.
Yep. Right.
All of us, if we sat down, even my dad, who's my biggest hero, when we talk long enough, I will disagree with my dad. Mm-hmm. Yeah. And if we talk rules from 1 to 60, we're going to find disagreements. But we don't have to agree on 50, 52, and 57. We agree on 1 and 2. Love the Lord your God with our hearts, our mind, and strength, and love your neighbor as yourself. Yeah. Man, if we agreed on that, the world would change, because the Christians would change the world. Mm. And everything.
It's the citizenship thing, right? Like, we don't agree with a lot of citizens that live in our country, but we aren't, like, changing citizenship.
Just figure out how to live.
But I'm just talking about the believers.
Right.
240,000 churches in the U.S. Could you imagine if 240,000 churches were out there at every homeless shelter, at every soup kitchen, at every orphanage, not just going to a building on Sunday? It would totally drastically change, starting with the U.S. and then into other countries.
Yeah. My agent in Los Angeles, again, weird flex, I know.
My agent, okay, Los Angeles.
In LA, that's two.
You gotta put a dollar on it.
I'm surprised you didn't say my agency.
Man. We gotta get this guy back in the real world.
I was like trying to connect with a fan, and I was like, talk to my assistant. But, now he knows that I'm a part of this community that he doesn't really understand that well. And there was two churches in the same city. They wanted to bring me in, and both of them couldn't afford it. Again.
Wait.
Anyway, so he says, why don't you just get the churches together? Mm. And I go, well, whose building is it going to be at? Yeah. And they said, well, that was like, well, they're not going to do it.
Yeah.
They won't, because you're going to say all these people, send them
to that place,
to the rival or the competitor.
There you go.
They're not going to do that. But if you don't, we live in this world that I go, don't even ask, they won't do that.
Yeah.
A bunch of times we've flown to different places, and it's to tie into how, like, so many churches, you know, haven't united or done. Like, we'll be in, I don't know if it was Atlanta or somewhere else, so you see a church, and then, like, 30 feet, another church, and another church. And I would ask them, like, they don't chill. They don't, like, do outreaches together. We're like, nah, they're just pretty much all, they're like 10 feet apart, you know?
Oh, we're in Tennessee. They're about 7 feet apart here.
Yeah.
They're every corner.
That's one of the reasons why we do clubs.
Yeah.
Because if we do a church, the other churches won't go.
Yeah.
And so if you do a club, it's a neutral venue.
Yeah.
And now everyone's going to come to it.
Sometimes you think of a neutral venue as neutral to believers and non-believers, but you're having to select a neutral venue just to get all of the Christians together.
Yeah.
But if, again, it's like Tim's saying, if it's something bigger, like a Billy Graham crusade, we're all on that team. Everybody's on that team. But it seems like with the denominations, we get divided up. You're like, he untucks his shirts over there at that church. Yeah. Nah, we're not done. And then we hate him.
That's not a non-negotiable.
Yeah.
That is not a non-negotiable for me. Yeah. I don't care if that church has a tie or they can untuck their shirts or the choir is this way. It's not a non-negotiable.
Yeah.
There are only a few non-negotiables.
Yeah.
And for me, that's Jesus.
Yeah.
You know?
And that may be what we've lost sight of, because I don't think anybody who has these non-negotiables is going, I'm being unreasonable and I get it. You know, they're going like, this really matters to me, and this feels like a core part of my faith. Yeah. And I need to say this because it feels so core to me. And it's not. And so it's just a matter of how do we tell our friends, like, hey, that those other three things that are so huge to you, yeah, all that stuff that people go like, I have to stand on that. You go, how can we meet and just it be Jesus?
Right. I think it begins inside of all of us individually, though, in terms of like, are you kind? Are you nice? Yeah. Like,
I mean,
Jesus'
around the table,
prayer
right?
is a interesting read, because his last prayer is not for the world, right, although he loves the world. Mm-hmm. His last prayer is for the believers of the world, mm-hmm, which is a beautiful indication that the hope of any community is found in the believers of that community. Mm-hmm. It's what you're saying. And so I don't necessarily think it's like, I don't think unity is like, okay, we're all doing a crusade together. I think unity is a posture of our heart, to say that we're headed in the same direction. You know what I mean? Yeah. And I think we have to get rid of competition. You have to get rid of comparison. You have to get rid of criticism. And I think that the character of the church has to be restored. And that's what you're saying. It's like people go down like, dude, we just crush people. Like, are we
people
of grace?
So how do you do that in Miami? This isn't my interview, but you've got a church there, and there are other churches there.
It's been really fun, like, starting and leading a church, because I grew up, once again, like, four generations, Pentecostal preacher, like, all like that. I grew up in church, you know. Like, my first slow dance was to Our God is an Awesome God. Like, I have real problems,
fun of that
dude.
Song, you too?
No, I'm serious. Like,
it's on every mission trip highlight
it's
video.
It's powerful, and it's still, you know, my wife and I, we still play it, you know? Yeah, we still, literally, I just like, so like, I've always been around church, but like, starting one and leading one, it's like, you begin to deconstruct, like, what is it we're actually doing? Like, I think you just said, it's like, is it about a building and about a production? And don't get me wrong, there's all these like aspects, of course, that you're gonna gather, and you want the gathering to be good. But I think in the idea of building a community, it's like, we're trying and we're aiming at to build a community that says you can belong here before you believe, you can belong before you behave. And it's going on the journey with people. And so Miami, yeah, I think every space has its own different factors, but Miami's got its own host of factors. These guys actually helped us start the church, both these guys, which is hilarious that we're all in this room together. But I think just coming back to that, the real thing of like, everyone needs to have that friend, like you were saying earlier, like everyone's got to have some real people. There's going to be criticism. There's going to be challenges. But do you have the right they that you're listening to?
But, Rich, I want to go back to the point you just made a second ago about being sort of on the same team. How you're talking about is, as believers, we are in the same team, and we're on the same team because we have the same Heavenly Father, i.e. same coach for this example. Yeah. But that means we're on a team. I've been on a lot of teams. Some good, some bad, and you don't like everyone on your team. Mm-hmm. But that's the thing about Christianity. We're not called to like people. Yeah. We're called to love people. Mm-hmm. That means people that you might not like, people you might not associate with other ways, but we're not called to like people. I don't have to associate with people because I like them. I do it because I'm called to love them, and I'm called to value them because God put value on them.
Right.
And I think that's just something like, oh, well, we're going to talk because we like, I'm going to find people I like at the church. Yeah. No, living a sold out life for Jesus is not about going to places that you like. Mm. And I got to see that firsthand from my dad, you know, moving to other countries. My sister moving to other countries where, you know, there's so many things and that are hurting, people being persecuted, Christians being persecuted over and over again. They don't always like it. They don't, I mean, there's a lot of times they don't like it. Right. They don't like where they live. They don't like their tiny little house. They don't like how little money they have. They don't like any of those things. But it's still worth it because they're still loving those people anyways when they don't like it. Right. And I just think like we have to learn from so many of those people who have gone before us that this isn't a life about trying to find people and stuff we like. It's about having a life that matters.
I heard someone say the other day, like, this generation doesn't need something to live for. They need something worth dying for. Mm-hmm. And I think that there's a little bit, I guess the big change between, you know, 2,000 years ago when Christ came is that, like, being a Christian 2,000 years ago wasn't very popular. You know, we didn't have a cool Instagram page, and, you know, the greatest persecution wasn't what shoes you're wearing, but rather it was like, if you keep preaching this, we're going to kill you. And so I think that shared suffering, and that's a shared suffering brings about a unity.
Yeah. No doubt.
You know, when you go through something with somebody, man, it's like, yo, bro, like, my wife and I have been through some stuff. Like, it's hard to get in between the two of us. We've been through some fire together. And I don't know, I think there's a level of what you're saying completely, which is everything's based upon our preference and consumerism, which takes away the conviction and the heart of what this whole thing is about to begin with, which just creates room for division. I don't like the way you said that. Like, I don't, like, and assuming the worst and even thinking that my opinion, everyone can have an opinion. You don't always have a right to share that opinion, you know? Right. So
I think
you're onto something. I just don't know how we fully get there other than starting with
we'll
the man in the mirror.
We'll get through with Torrin's music.
Yes, that's how
we
exactly. Well, sorry, Torrin.
No, let's bring it back to why we're here.
No, I think it's good. Like, to kind of button up that conversation, you really can't have unity without diversity. Yeah. Unity without diversity is just sameness. And so we're really just celebrating. You're like me, I'm like you. Yeah.
It's not
when really, it's when all of us agree that we are different. But we come together and say, this matters more.
Yep. Yeah. It literally just reminded me, I got to share that message last Thursday in a prison. And in this block that I was sharing with, it was a lot of the worst that were from the worst gangs, and they're all different. And it was every color, every background, and even a lot of different faiths in this block. And so, you know, they were surprised by how I came at them. About the backgrounds, and we have so much that separates us. You part of this gang, you part of this gang, and I'm talking to him about it, and talking about your background. Oh, so you don't like him because you were born in that side of the tracks rather than that side, and this is true. There is literally, I hate you because I was born on this side. You were born on this side, and I got to know these guys for a while, and then it was like I get that you might never fully get over those differences. You might never get over those. Until you have something that matters more. And then I got to share the hope of Jesus with them. And now you have the same Heavenly Father. So instead of you and you being brothers, but he's out because he was born on this side, now you're all brothers because you have the same Heavenly Father. And it's like those differences that we were fighting and that our culture is fighting with, our backgrounds and our affiliations and what we like and color and everything else that that divide us. Well, it brings us together because God brings us together as our Heavenly Father, as our dad. Now we're into a bigger family, a deeper family, a more important family.
A family where we are called citizens of heaven.
Wow, so, track one.
It's a very long track.
A lot of times we can get so deep, but it's really, really ain't even that complicated. Just be nice, man.
Yeah.
So many believers are mean.
And we're
and all weird.
Yeah.
Yeah. Yeah. Yeah. Bro, you're like just super weird. You know
what I mean? Yeah, yeah, yeah. But you gotta love them. Yeah, I
love them. You don't have to like them.
Yeah, yeah, weird eye energy, man.
And to even take that one step farther, sweetness of speech increases persuasiveness.
Oh wow!
So
that's a proverb.
When we're kind, and then we're sweet to them, and we're caring, it's gonna increase them listening to what we have to say.
Yeah.
You know,
really
just
good.
Think it's cool to be able to
that's
put
really
those two
good.
Together.
Yeah.
You know,
that's really good.
I remember when I first came back to church. From not going to church for like years.
Wow.
And
bro.
Being how like, this is so awkward. Like, you know, like I stop that.
No, I'm just saying.
But, but I remember walking in and being like, what do we do? Like I forgot like how to be in church. I forgot how to like worship. I forgot how to like walk in. It was awkward just meeting the guy at the front door.
But
and
they should it so. Shouldn't be like that you have to forget.
It was
how
at
to
Voo
be.
Church actually.
Yeah. Yeah. You should But church should just be a place where it literally doesn't matter what you wear into it, how you say it, how you come, how you approach it.
It should be. But I remember going and I went to church back by myself, and that's why it was hard. If I'm not a believer, how am I if I'm walking into my church as a non-believer, like how can I make it more comfortable? You know?
Yeah.
How can I make it more comfortable
Absolutely.
For someone who doesn't know how to experience? So again, that's why we do neutral venues, because a non-believer feels okay with going to, you know, a club.
Which
going to
I've
club
heard you
live
say
to
this. You said Fern got out of prison, you got out of religion. Like
Probably.
Both held captive but in different places.
Wow.
What was your journey when you say you got out of religion? That like shakes a lot of people, but what's your heart in that?
I remember when I left the church, my buddy told me, he's like, God's rebuilding you. It's like you're joining a fraternity where they start to like, you know, reshape you and reshape the foundation. So for me, I started going back to church and God started showing me this is what it's really about, loving people. And like, one thing I don't like is when I have something to say and someone has that phrase, like they have an immediately, like they have the church response.
Yes.
Sometimes as somebody who's dealing with depression or anxiety, you want someone to just listen to you.
Yeah.
Yeah.
And give you just like, hey, I love you.
Yeah.
That's all I got for you.
I'm terrible at that. My wife gets so mad at me. She's like, I don't want you to fix this. I just want you to be like, this sucks.
Don't give me the 1, 2, 3. Well, number one, are you reading your Bible? Like, I know that's important.
Yes.
But for me, sometimes when you're venting, you just want someone to be like, dude, I love you and I'm here
with
you.
So what would you say to someone that has been hurt by the church or hurt by religion in the way that you were?
I'd probably say your experience is not like, there's a lot of us who have experienced that. You know, it's not just, it's not like a one-time thing, like you were damaged. For me, I felt like you know, seeing my pastor fall into what he fell into, and it made me question, we speak about God, but are we really like believing this? Like, I wanted to be a part of something that was real.
Right.
And so I would say it is real. You know, we serve a God who's not dead. He is very much alive, and he very much cares about you. And even if you're watching this, you know, this is just us telling you, like, there's a real God who really loves you. And I think it's all about the community. And I didn't have community. That's one thing at the church we never had. So I remember my buddy Kanata, when I started going back to church, he would just, you know, make me go, you know? Mm-hmm. And if I didn't have someone like that, like if I didn't have a good friend,
yeah,
I don't really know where I'd be.
Man.
If I didn't have somebody like
that is huge.
Who loved me through the dirt and yeah. saw, like they saw the downhill from my life. Mm-hmm. If I didn't have somebody, even seeing all that, being like, dude, I love you. Like, you're better than this. Like, it comes back to identity.
It's great. Yeah. Yeah.
You know, I need someone who reminded me of my, you know, I'm a citizen of heaven.
Strong.
Love it. I feel like VU and the church community that we're a part of, I feel like if you're hurt, it's a good place to go. Mm-hmm. Because it's like, a lot of us were raised in Christian families, so we've grown up, and I feel like that's why we can make fun of it, because we're like so used to it. You know, it's like, yeah. why are we doing this? Like, I remember when you were talking about the hand raising, like different hand raising.
Oh, yeah.
Like, it's so funny. Like, we could poke fun of the stuff that we all did yeah. growing up in church, and I feel like it's healing. That's
well,
healing.
Spirit, the spirit behind that, the point is like, worship however you want.
Yeah.
It's not, we're doing like, oh, if you're a Methodist, you do this. If you're charismatic, you do this. You're like, because we all think that, but if you break it down, it's like, dude, you're having an interaction with the creator of the universe. I love all you guys, but I don't care what y'all think.
Right.
Sorry.
It's also cool to be like, that's weird. And I feel like in the church, we're afraid to like say like,
yeah,
dude,
this is different.
It's like, it's weird.
My first time at church, I remember this lady pulled out a flag and started like doing backflips and stuff. Like,
whose
it
church was that?
It was rendezvous
with the mind.
Yeah, and I remember he had a sword
it was
and stuff.
Though. It was lit.
I remember seeing that, and
you'd have felt something.
It's the type of church you gotta look at your friend while you're there, and you're like, "This doesn't normally happen."
You know what I'm saying?
It's like one of those Sundays. We don't normally talk about blood moons here. Just want to let you know, but like, yeah.
And I actually want to ask this question too. Sometimes the things we're most known for are not the things that we most value in ourselves. Mm. So, like, Stephen Furtick plants a church, and he's this, like, masterful communicator, but then he starts writing songs.
Yeah.
And it's almost like people are like, well, you're a preacher. Mm. You don't get to write songs. Or, well, no, you're a football player. You're not supposed to be a philanthropist. Mm-hmm. Like, I don't understand that. That, you know, so I got to write with Stephen Furtick on this song.
That's amazing.
Having said that,
he is a songwriter. Caveat.
I love it.
And so cool. A lot of my songs are inspired by messages that I hear. And I would like to know, what inspires you? Like, where do you pull when you're going to write a sermon, write a book, when you're thinking of who you're going to bring on the podcast? Like, what's that spark for you?
I think I'm a pretty observant person. Maybe all of us are, because we're all creative in some way. So I think if you're a creative person, that means you're an observant person. Mm-hmm. So it's really That's just cool. looking at the life, or either other people's lives and kind of pulling inspiration from that. Or if I've gone through something personally, of course, I'll write about that. It's kind of a simple answer, but that's always being aware of your surroundings and kind of try to be in touch
with. Are you sort of like always in a state where like, oh, that like that's an idea, and then you put it in your phone or something? Or you kind of sit down and go, here's my time now to create? Or
it's,
is it
both?
Yeah, I think both. Probably more the first thing, just because I think it hits me randomly. Like, I'll be at dinner or something and get like an idea, and then I'll have to jot it in my phone, or like a melody or something. But sometimes it's later too, because I'm a pretty late processor, so even leaving this discussion, I'll probably leave and
you're
be like
thinking of stuff.
I should have said
What do you do with a melody? Do you turn on the voice and
usually sing like a voice memo.
Can we hear some of those?
You
write something down and you're like, yeah, and then like you see it the next day, you're like, yeah.
What do you do though? You're writing jokes every day.
Yeah.
You're
just, yeah. Well,
in your phone, what's that? What does that process look like?
I write it in my phone. Yeah, just, I was like, this is something. Well, I always think about what is the avenue for this? Is this a tweet? Is this an Instagram? Is this an Instagram story? Is this a sketch video? Is it a stand-up video? Is it going to a book?
I don't know why I'm laughing about just the way he even explains it.
I think it'd be safe to say about all of us, somebody told me if you're going to be a prolific comic, you should write about what you know about. Mm-hmm. So I grew up in church. My dad's a pastor. Let's say I was writing a joke about the good versus the bad neighborhoods of Miami. You know, I don't know. So I'm not.
It's not authentic.
Or somebody in a church that probably knows more of the neighborhood. Like, I'm not equipped to write that joke. Mm-hmm. So like if a difference between men and women, a million people could make that kind of sketch. But if you make a video like a spoof on House Hunters called Church Hunters and the jokes
one
or
of
the
my
worship
faves.
Leader draft, like I was like,
sore subject.
But I don't know who else could make that. And if everybody's doing great, this music could only come from you.
Yeah,
then you're
really
making the great stuff.
And Madeline Engel has this quote where she says, spirituality and art is when we turn chaos into cosmos. Mm-hmm. And I think that's what you're saying, Tori, is that what we get to do as artists in whatever form is we look at chaos and we go, but I see how that aligns into something. Yeah. And
beautiful.
So I feel like that's the inspiration often is this feels chaotic. Is there any cosmos in this? Mm-hmm. Is there any sense in this? Because then the art can have a Christian label or not. And if it's that same unity thing where you go, hey, I don't agree with everything you said, but you turned chaos into cosmos for me. Mm-hmm. And so that art is spiritual to me.
When you're writing a book, do you start with like just big idea? You're like, oh, I feel like I want to talk about bravery. And so like,
I think so.
That is it like a title that begins with for you? Like, and you're like, now
no,
I'm going to
add content?
No, I think
it's something that feels broken. Mm. Maybe in me the most.
Good.
That's really
good.
Where I go, this thing feels broken in me. I've got to start writing until I find it.
Wow.
And then I go to the counselor and we heal it.
Yeah.
Right? Yeah. And so I think that's where it starts. Is it starts in my own chaos. And then I look for the cosmos. And that, I mean, that's what y'all do too, is you invite people in. When John makes those jokes, when you do that, when you preach, like, what you go is you go, I saw chaos. I made it into cosmos. I bet there's chaos in you too. And people go, there was chaos in me. But look, there's hope that there's cosmos, that there's something beautiful that aligns.
It's really good.
And amazing. I think that's what we get to do.
I love that because I feel like for me personally, like that's how I write. Mm-hmm. And I feel like in this season, if it means a lot to me, and I at this point, I feel like I want to write a song that's so open and honest that will help heal somebody else. But at the same time, like this new project we just put out, it was so open for us that I remember my mom calling me. She's like, this really happened. Like, I'm sorry. I wasn't there for you.
Yeah, wow.
But it was like, that was a part of my healing process, putting this on paper. But I know in the deepest parts of my transparency, that's what's going to heal somebody. Like, unless we're honest with people, people are not going to be healed.
Yeah.
You know, like, and I think that's where comedy, it, to me, is so important because you're poking fun at the thing that, you know, it's like finally we're being honest about something, you know? And like once we start censoring music and comedy, like that's when the world's gonna just implode. Frank Sinatra said this. He said, he never really wrote songs with people and over things that he didn't feel. He goes, I can't sing if I don't feel it. And I feel like we can't write a song unless we've been through it. And even yesterday we had an interview with this media company and they're asking us questions. I'm like, I don't know. Because we live in South Florida where our perspective is different than someone who lives in Ohio. Mm-hmm. You know, like I can talk about what I know.
Right. But the idea in there, finding purpose in all of that, you know, making everything that you do redeemable.
Yeah.
You know, you guys talk about this on your project, Doom. There's a line that you say, it's never been about fame. It's just about purpose.
Absolutely.
How have you navigated fame versus purpose? And has there been a time where you had to make an actual decision? I know this is the move that moves me forward, but this is the move that I can make with integrity. How do you handle that? I would like to hear from both of y'all on that.
To me, popularity and influence and the word fame, like that is just a platform. And it's an expiring platform. Mm-hmm. And so while we have this 15 minutes, let's glorify God.
Ooh.
You know what I'm saying? Like, it's going to fade. And I think about, you know, we were talking about yesterday, like how many artists last year were so popular? Yeah. And then you forget about them. Yeah. You know, like I was watching this documentary on this well-known rapper last year. He was huge. And he was like, every day I buy a new pair of shoes. And I'm like, hopefully this lasts. Like, save the money that you have.
Yeah.
Because what's going to happen when this is all over? And so fame or whatever we can call it, it's really just a platform for us to share what we believe. And so in this 15 minutes, I want to be a good steward. I want to have a life of integrity. And this has been, I mean, we had one of our biggest shows. Like, we were offered a lot of money. It was my wife's, it was her cousin's birthday, a wedding. And so I was like, Fern, is it okay if we miss this? And he's like, for a family, yes. So we missed this big opportunity for a wedding.
Yeah.
Because, you know, at the end of the day, when the fame and all that is gone, all I have is my wife and my family.
Wisdom.
And so who really cares about, I mean, we can come back to Atlanta.
Right.
We'll come back to Atlanta. It'll be there in another year.
Yeah.
But God forbid I lose my marriage because I kept choosing being on tour.
It's really good, man.
Wow. Yeah,
it's great. And that's scary because I mean, we all know somebody who's possibly made that decision.
Yeah.
To me, the fame never mattered, especially being a father and a husband as well. When I go home, I get all the fame I need. You know what I mean? I'm so famous at my house.
Yes.
You know what I'm saying? Yes. Like, my boy texts me, Dad, I love you so much. My son's 5 years old.
Yeah.
He texts me. We have a bond on the telephone. He's like, Dad, I need you to come to my room. He texts me. He's in the other room real quick. Yeah. And I'll just come in and just spend time. So something that hit me like a ton of bricks, it's no longer spending time because I'm trying to make up time. Mm-hmm. I'm investing.
Good. That's good.
I'm investing it. I'm seeing the change in my son. I asked him the other day. I said, you love when Daddy's just chilling with you, always just chilling with you, right? He's like, he goes like this.
Yeah. Well, you know, some say you spell love T-I-M-E.
That's what it is. Presence, not presence.
Yeah. This idea, more, I need more. How much bigger can it get? How much more can I do? How much more can I fit into my calendar? And I don't think that that's just unique to people in the spotlight. Like, that's the mother trying to figure out how to divide her time with all of her children. That's the businessman that's trying to provide a real life for his kids, and they think that that's connected to how much money or overtime they get, and now you're just a prisoner to that job. I think it's a tension that we all deal with. How have you pursued purpose over notoriety?